I'm very excited to introduce T.R. Reid. He's a longtime correspondent for the Washington Post, where he covered Congress as well as four presidential campaigns. He also served as the Post bureau chief in Tokyo and London. He has written 10 books in English, including the 2009 national bestseller, The Healing of America, as well as three in Japanese and translated one from Japanese. He's also made several documentaries for National Geographic Television, PBS, and the A&E Network, and he's a commentator for NPR. In his new book that we're here to discuss, A Fine Mess, A Global Quest for a Simpler, Fairer, and More Efficient Tax System, TR travels the world in search of solutions for the urgent tax problems that plague the U.S. tax code. If you've ever read one of his books, you know that he has an ability to make complex subjects compelling and easy to understand. And according to the praise that's already coming out for the book, he's once again accomplished that. Kirkus Reviews described it as a well-reported and clearly written expose of the United States tax policy, which he makes relentlessly revelatory. Thank you. I'm getting there. And simple to understand. So without further ado, please help me in welcoming T.R. Reid to Politics and Prose.
Thanks, Michael. Hi, everybody. I'm just delighted to be here. I'm really delighted to see you here. I'm so pleased to see people on a perfect Palm Sunday coming out to support the local bookstore, and particularly this bookstore, because Politics and Prose is a great civic amenity for this city. We all know it, and we need to support it. It's been, I think this has been just a great part of D.C. for decades, I guess, but even better since Brad and Lissa bought it. They've really made something out of the store. It's fantastic to see what they've done. Brad and Lissa were my colleagues at the Washington Post back in the days when Kay Graham was running the paper. She was called the most powerful woman in America, and the great Ben Bradley was our editor. And we always said the best possible byline for a Washington Post reporter was Bradley Graham. And he had it. So
It used to be Rosenthal Salzberger, but I changed.
That's right. Just like that. Rosenthal. And I'm very pleased to see some members of Princeton's greatest class in attendance here today. So that's good news. And I'm pleased to be here so I can talk about my new book. This book, A Fine Mess, it's about taxes. It follows a kind of a pattern I've been doing for a few books now, which I think you might call comparative policy analysis or best practices. Basically, the argument is, if your club or your college or your company or your country has a problem, well, a good way to fix that problem is to look at what other clubs or colleges or countries have done and see if they've come up with a good idea. And this works pretty well for taxes, because it turns out any idea that anybody left, right, or center has had to fix our tax code, some country somewhere has tried it. We have very good laboratory experimentation. And what I concluded looking around the world is there's a lot of, our tax code is rotten. It's unfair. It's incredibly complicated. It's inefficient. We should fix it, and we could fix it, because other countries like us have really done a better job for the most part. They've made some mistakes, but basically there's a lot we could learn. I got into this line of work, comparative policy analysis, give it a fancy term, because I was a foreign correspondent. I was working at the Washington Post with Brad and Lissa, and I like Brad and Lissa. They were fine, but the thing about working at in the Washington Post newsroom, it's fun. There's a lot of buzz. There's a lot of camaraderie. The problem is, I don't know, you've seen all the president's men. Everybody sits in rows, and then at the end of the row is your editor. And this is an excellent architecture for putting out a daily newspaper, I suppose, but I never liked it, because you're never more than 10 feet from the boss. And I just, you know, she could come around and read over your shoulder. I hated that. So I spent a lot of time thinking about it. I liked the paper. I liked the work. I just didn't want to be that close to the boss. So I kept thinking, how could I do this job and be more than 10 feet from the boss? And I came up with a pretty drastic solution. I moved 10,000 miles from the boss. I became a foreign correspondent, and this worked great. They pretty much left me alone. I developed a career formula that I recommend to all young people. My basic plan is never work within 10 time zones of the boss. This worked out great for me. They never bugged me. And it was fun. Our family of five Americans had a lot of fun living overseas. It was, particularly in East Asia where everything's different, it was always interesting. Like from the first or second day we were in Tokyo, I was walking down the street with my three kids, and there's a stand on the street, and the guy's saying, tacos, tacos. We thought, well, that's pretty. My kids had been afraid about what they would have to eat in Japan, you know. So I said, well, how bad can it be? They have tacos. So I gave each of my kids 100 yen and said, go over and buy a taco. And my two little girls came running back and said, ooh, gross. Most disgusting tacos I've ever seen. And what's going on here is, in Japanese, the word taco means octopus. And this gentleman was selling baby octopus on a toothpick. You could either have them grilled or raw. And my 13-year-old American boy, of course, he had a raw octopus just to prove how tough he was. I think it's the last one he ever had, but it was fun. We were fun. And I think I know that we lived overseas for years, and it definitely made us better Americans. All my kids to this day, we like our country better. And here's why. When you're here, you can see the problems. I mean, after our last election, you can see the problems in our country. You get 10,000 miles away and look back, and the United States of America looks pretty good. I mean, we are the richest, strongest, most innovative, freest country in the world, and you can see that, I think, more clearly or sometimes when you're looking from afar. So I think we all became better Americans. The downside was, well, not a downside so much, but you know, every once in a while we had to go to the doctor. My son fell off his skateboard in Tokyo and fractured his clavicle. I had a daughter who constantly got otitis media, earaches. And at first we were kind of wary about going to a foreign doctor. I mean, we're Americans. We know that we do everything best. Are you going to take your child to a foreign doctor? Well, we did. You're not going to fly home for an earache, you know, kind of thing. So. And guess what? Here's what we found in all the rich countries. Very good care, certainly an American standard of care. The facilities were fine. They weren't as fancy as you would find in America, but just fine. We didn't have to wait that long. But the really striking thing were the bills. The bills were 1/10, 1/20 what you would pay for the same treatment in America. When we lived in Tokyo, quite often I didn't bother to send the doctor bill home to Washington to the insurance company, because the postage was more than the doctor bill. That's absolutely the case. So I got interested in this just as a reporter. How do they do this? How do they provide very good care? Because all the rich countries have better health outcomes than we do, without much waiting, at such low cost. And I decided to go around the world and go to the doctor and see how they do it. And I went to my editor at Penguin Press, Ann Godoff, the great Ann Godoff, a great editor. I said, Ann, this is a brilliant idea. I'm going to go to the doctor around the world and see how they treat me. And you could just see in her face, oh, God, you know, health policy. She said, I've done health policy. Those books never sell. They never sell. She really didn't like this idea, but my last book had done pretty well. I came here and sold that, my previous book. And so she kind of had to buy it. It was an expensive book for her. She had to send me around the world. And then while I was doing that book, I had made some movies for PBS Frontline, and the editors at Frontline said, going to the doctor around the world, yeah, there's a movie in that. So they sent me back around the world again to see the same docs and the same economists. And of course, you know, PBS Frontline, that's funded by viewers like you, so you bought me dinner in Paris, and I'm grateful. Anyway, through sheer luck, the timing on that book was perfect. My healthcare book came out right when Washington, D.C. was debating Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act. And people who buy books were interested in health policy. And that book, it just went crazy. We sold a lot of that book right in this store, I'm pleased to say. And hit the New York Times list the first week. Most of my books have flopped. This was really unusual for me to have that happen. And it's still selling pretty well. And about a year later, Ann Godoff from Penguin called me just to chat, and she said, man, that book of yours, that healthcare book, is just selling like crazy. It's fabulous. She said, God, I'm so glad I had the idea. Well, it was my idea. But, you know, she's the boss. She's a great editor. I said, yeah, Ann, great idea you had. It was great. So about, now it's 3 years ago, Ann called me and said, okay, here's my next idea. We're going to have a big national debate on tax reform, so go look at taxes around the world and see if we can catch the same wave. And, of course, once again, I missed two deadlines, and I was late on the book. And we brought it out this week, just when Donald Trump said we're going to move on to tax reform. So let's hope somebody gets interested. And the idea, again, is to see what other countries have done to see if we can fix our rotten tax code by looking around the world. And I think in addition to figuring out what might work and what doesn't work, another interesting thing about doing this comparative study of taxes, it answers this kind of interesting question. Do Americans pay too much tax? Are we overtaxed? I mean, do we pay more tax than people in other rich countries like us? Well, one expert, I will quote him, Donald Trump, said many times, as candidate and as president, the United States is the highest tax country in the world. Is he right? You're saying this is an alternative fact? Yeah, as a matter of fact, this is an alternative fact. There is a standard way to measure tax burden, the cost of tax. It's called overall tax burden. The OECD and the World Bank measure this. And here's what you do. You take all the taxes in a country, federal, state, and local, total them up, and take them as a percentage of GDP, of total wealth. Where do you think the U.S. rates? Well, first, let me ask you this question first. Who do you think are the biggest taxers in the world? Who are the world champions at taxing a lot? Sweden, Belgium, and Denmark. Sweden and Denmark, about 49% of all wealth goes in taxes. Half of all the wealth they create goes in taxes. Of course, they get a lot out of it. They get a lot of government out of it. And that's kind of an interesting side question, which I mentioned in my book but didn't go into. We all know, any American knows, that high taxes stifle economic growth, right? This is a given. So Denmark has a tax burden of 49%, way higher than ours. They've had higher growth rates almost every year for the last three decades than the United States. So what happened to that theory? Anyway, that's homework, because I didn't explain that one. But the United States, of the 35 richest countries in total tax burden, we rate 32nd. Chile, Mexico, and South Korea have slightly lower tax burdens than we do. The European democracies have tax burdens in the range of 40 to 49% of total wealth, and America's is 25%. We pay less in income tax, in Social Security tax, in sales tax, in gas tax, in tobacco tax than most other countries. Now, to offset that, Americans give much more in private charity than any other company. We give 100 times as much as the average Frenchman in charity. And that's because those European countries expect government to do the stuff that we prefer to do through private charity. The place where we charge more is the corporate income tax. As you've heard, our corporate income tax, it's graduated, but for most big companies, it's 35%. And that is higher than almost any other country. The world champion at gouging the rich in general and at gouging corporations is France. They have a higher corporate tax rate than we do. But it's true. Now, of course, any corporation that actually paid 35% in tax would fire its CFO the next morning. No company would do that. But even if you take the effective rate, the amount they actually pay, we are higher on the corporate tax, and it's not working. Corporations have become extremely skillful at steering their profits to tax havens overseas. A lot of American profits have been relocated to Bermuda. Now, Bermuda is a beautiful country with pink beaches and a 0% corporate tax rate. So let's put our money there. And they do that. I go through this in my book, how they do this. So we should cut that corporate tax rate. It's just not working. And it gets to a sort of basic truth I saw all over the world. That is, if you set the tax rate really high, then people don't pay it. Then it's worth your while to hire a lawyer or an accountant and find a way to duck it. There's diminishing returns as rate goes up. For a while, France, which as I said is the world champion at gouging the rich, had a 75% top rate. And if you remember the great actor Gerard Depardieu went to Belgium, a lot of people went to Belgium or Britain, and they had to cut that rate. It just wasn't working. So there is a limit to how much you can charge. The other area where Americans pay, at least in the top half of the rich countries, is the estate tax, the inheritance tax. I personally really like this tax. This is a tax that doesn't tax savings, it doesn't tax investment, it doesn't tax labor. By definition, if you work for the money, you don't pay the inheritance tax on it. You only get it if you're a lucky rich kid whose uncle left you $50 million. So, and you have to inherit at least $11 million in America before you pay a penny of estate tax. So I think this is a good tax. However, what's interesting is many countries that you and I would consider pretty lefty have eliminated the estate tax. Canada got rid of the estate tax. Sweden and Denmark got rid of the estate tax. In Canada, and the argument for this is, hey, enough is enough. Jesus, I paid tax for 65 years. Don't tax me when I'm dead. And this was turned into a very clever slogan in Canada. The slogan was, no taxation without respiration. I really like that. And then Sweden got rid of the estate tax. That seems counter to my image of Sweden. And I asked an economist there, he's quoted in my book, and was this tongue-in-cheek? He said, you know, we tax them so much when they're alive, they don't have anything left to give to the kids. So maybe that's it. But so those are two areas. The corporate tax, we are higher than almost anybody, and the estate tax, we're in the top half. But I think those are good taxes. So Americans pay less in tax. Does this help now that you're 10 days away from having to pay your tax, or 9 days? Make you feel better? No. We pay less in tax than other countries, but we complain about it more than anybody else. Americans are really the world champs at bitching about tax, and I think that is related to the fact that we don't like government that much. You know, we don't have the feeling that government is a helping hand like Europeans tend to feel. One of the guys who famously complained about our tax code even though he's a big winner under our tax laws, was Mitt Romney. If you remember, in 2012, Mitt Romney complained that 47% of people don't pay any income tax. Well, you know, that's true. That number is about right. But those people still pay Social Security tax, sales tax, gas tax, liquor tax, et cetera, property tax. They get taxed. They're not walking away scot-free. But he complained about this, which kind of bugged me, because Romney is, as I said, is a big winner in our tax code. We have designed a tax code so that the rates are progressive. That is, the more you make, the higher rate you pay, except for investment bankers and hedge funders at the very top, in the top 1% of all wage earners. We've got a system where they pay less. You've seen the bumper sticker. Warren Bumper paid a lower tax rate than his secretary. Warren Buffett, and Warren Buffett confirms that's true, because we've written this system. And Mitt Romney was a big winner. This is called the carried interest loophole, and Mitt Romney was a big winner. During his campaign, he was forced, I'm sure he now regrets it, but he was forced to release two tax returns. His tax return for 2010 showed that he made $22 million that year. And this was all money from the company that he had resigned from a dozen years earlier. They were still paying him $22 million a year. And he paid tax on it at a rate of 13%, which is less than a family of four making 1% of what he earned. So he made out fine. I don't think he should have been complaining about taxes. Another interesting thing that came out in Mitt Romney's tax return is it showed that he had money in the Cayman Islands. He had money in a bank in the Cayman Islands. And the Caymans, you know, they're a notorious tax haven. There's really only one reason to put money in the, it's not because you trust the bankers there, you know. But Mitt Romney, he was criticized for this. And so he said, well, yes, we have some funds in the Caymans, but not for tax purposes. And the tax lawyer, Frank Shookit, famously said, well, to say you have money in the Caymans, but not for tax purposes, is like saying, yeah, I bought those condoms, but not for sex. While we bitch and complain about tax in a totally standard drill on Capitol Hill, I used to cover this when I was a congressional correspondent, is when members of Congress call in the IRS and berate them, give them hell, because the code is so complicated. Well, they wrote the code. It's not, you know, this is called blaming the messenger kind of thing. It always ticked me off. And Americans, you know, we portray the IRS as terrorists, as criminals. Taxes, theft, all that stuff. A guy in 2012, a guy flew his plane into the IRS building in Austin, Texas, and killed four IRS himself and four IRS employees. That's how we feel. In other countries, interestingly, the IRS, the National Revenue Agency, is one of the most respected agencies. People are proud of it. Other officials of the IRS in Britain or Sweden or Chile or Japan, they have blazers with a badge on it. They have baseball caps. They have bands. They have mascots. They have slogans. The slogan of the Dutch IRS is, we can't make paying taxes pleasant, but we'll try to make it simple. It's pretty good, I think. In other words, in other countries, they're respected. In Chile, Chile's IRS has a mascot. It's a chinchilla. It's a little chinchilla. It's a, you know, somebody wears a chinchilla suit, like a mascot suit, goes around to malls and schools, and he says, son bacanes los impuestos. Those taxes, they're awesome. You know, schools, hospitals, roads, bridges, parks, it's because of your taxes that we have them. He goes everywhere. People love, his name is Evo, which is the male form of Evo, which means a value-added tax in Chile. People love him. In Japan, I really like this one. The movie that won Best Picture, Best Director, Best Actor, and Best Actress in Japan was Marasa no Ona, which means Audit Bureau Woman. Audit Bureau Woman. And here's what happens in this movie. The star is Miyamoto Nobuko, who's kind of the Meg Ryan or Amy Schumer or Reese Witherspoon of Japan, you know, pretty, peppy, lovable starlet. And Nobuko plays an auditor in the Tokyo Tax Bureau. And at the beginning of the movie, she's kind of a beginner. And so they assign her to small little tax dodgers. And so she's standing outside this little tiny mom and pop shop, counting all the sales, right? How much they sold. And then she goes in and gets the receipt and see how much tax they withheld and are going to pay. And she says to the mom and pop, hey, you sold 2 million yen worth of stuff this week and you're only paying 2,000 yen in tax. That's way off. And the mom is really anxious. The IRS is coming after us? And Nobuko, she's very serious. She gets out her calculator and says, yes, you owe 2,242,311 yen in back taxes, pay up. And the mom of the mom and pop gets furious and says, why are you going after us? Why don't you go after those big tax cheats? I see them all over the place. Nobuko thinks about this. She goes back to her boss and says, why don't you put me on a big account? You know, I'm tired of doing these little ones. And so he says, well, I'll give you the toughest guy I got. I'll give you the toughest guy I got. So she's now told to track this Yakuza figure, and he owns a chain of love hotels. These are two-hour shack-up hotels. You know, they have them all over Japan. And This guy is very rich. He rides around Tokyo in a chauffeured white Bentley and never pays any tax. And so throughout the movie, he's riding around from one of his love hotels to the next in his Bentley, and Nobuko is chasing him on this little red scooter. And in the climactic moment, she finds where he's kind of hidden all his documents, and she's digging through this mountain of old paper, finally finds the document that will send him to jail, and the whole audience cheers. They cheer. Now, I say in my book, can you imagine Meg Ryan or Amy Schumer nailing some tax escaper and everybody cheering for it? I don't know. Because we complain more. Now, why do we complain more? Well, I think part is this philosophical truth. We just don't like government as much as people in other, you know, in other countries. And we prefer to do things on our own, which is why we give more to charity than anybody else. But another reason is we've made it so hard. It's so hard. In fact, what are you guys doing here at a bookstore when it's only 9 days before your tax return is due? Nobody in the world has made it as difficult to pay taxes as we do. It's outrageous. It just drives. For the last 3 years, I've been writing this book, so I've been doing my own taxes. It just drives me crazy. There's a woman at the IRS who is the Nina Olson is the she's the officially designated taxpayer advocate. She's the ombudsman who's supposed to stand up for you and me, and she is required by law to make a report to Congress every year on the 10 worst problems facing American taxpayers. And she's had this job for 12 years now, and she says to me, you know, for 12 years, the number one problem has been that the tax code is just too complicated for taxpayers. And she says, every year they make it worse. She says she feels like Cassandra, you know, she makes this prediction and nobody listens to her. Anyway, so I said to Nina Olson, there's a point in my book where I'm kind of making fun of the IRS and how hard it is. And I said, here's what I need. I need a standard IRS instruction that's so complicated that it's funny. And Nina says, but there's so many of those. And we did find some real gems, some of which, a couple of which I have run across in real life. According to the IRS, an average American family at the median wage, that median income of $56,000, average family spends 13 hours a year gathering the data and filling out the forms and $360 to a preparer or to a software company. 13 hours and $360. All in all, American families spend 3.9 billion hours a year just to pay their taxes. It's outrageous. It doesn't have to be this way, because in other countries, it takes 10 minutes and $0 to pay. I was in Amsterdam on March 1st, a year ago. March 31st, I'm sorry, April 1st is their tax day. And I was with this, you know, mid-level manager in a Dutch company, Michael Spheres, and it was March 31st, his taxes were due the next day. Both his provincial and his federal tax return was due the next day. And we were kind of sitting around casually. It's 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. And I said, Michael, I wanted to see how you pay your taxes. He said, yeah, well, you know, I give it like 15 minutes a year and I'll show you. He says, here, have a beer. So he pops a beer, he goes online. And for both the provincial and the federal tax, this IRS, you remember the one that said we can make it simple? They've filled in every line of the return. If the numbers look right to him, he hits okay, and he's done in 5 minutes. Then he finishes his beer. But Michael says to me, he says, you know, I think I'm what you guys would call a Republican, I think. I says, I don't trust government much. So, you know, sometimes I start checking the numbers just to make sure they got them right. Now he's getting really pissed off. You know, he says, you know, sometimes, you know, you start checking those numbers, it can take half an hour just to pay your goddamn taxes. Outrageous. In Japan, for about 85% of workers, the COCUSHO, that's their IRS, sends you a postcard that says in early March, their tax day is April 1st. In early March, they send you a postcard that says, we think you earned this much. We withheld this much. Therefore, we owe you a refund of this much. We'll put it on your bank account on April 1st. Or you owe us this much, and we're going to take it out of your bank on April 1st. If that looks right to you, and it's always right, you do nothing. You don't have to file a return. For almost all Japanese, that's the case. And I said to my buddy Togo Shigehiko is my best friend in Japan, and I said to Togo, you know, in April, Americans, you know, beautiful spring days when we ought to be out playing golf or having a picnic. In America, you know, people spend hours or days just filling out their tax returns. And Togo says, why would anybody want to do that? And guess what? The IRS could fill out the return for most American families. They know all the numbers. They know how much you earned. They know how much was withheld. They know what your Social Security tax payment was. They know your itemized deduction. They know all your stock transactions because your investment company is required by law to report to them. They have all the numbers. I don't know if anybody here has ever gotten what's called a CP2000 notice from the IRS. I get these every year. This is the one that says, on line 48Q, you entered $4,211, and actually the number is $4,736. And I'm thinking, if they know that already, why did I spend hours adding up the number wrong or taking the wrong number from my investment? Just drives me crazy. They could do that for almost every taxpayer. The term for this is pre-filled forms, or sometimes pre-populated returns, the economists call that. Most rich countries now do this for most taxpayers, and the IRS could do it for most taxpayers, and there are a few members of Congress who have gotten behind this. Ron Wyden from Oregon, Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts, former Senator Dan Coats from Indiana, have proposed pre-filled forms for the United States, which we could do. And guess what? H&R Block lobbies against it. Intuit, the maker of the tax cut software, they lobby against it, and it never goes anywhere. It doesn't have to be this way. If we did it like other countries do, then April 15th would just be another sunny spring day. You could go out and have a picnic, and that's what we ought to do. I said that there are a lot of good ideas out there. There are some bad ideas. Many Republicans last in 2016, six of the Republican candidates endorsed a flat rate tax. This is the 18%. Everybody pays 18%. What could be fairer than that, right? Everybody pays the same rate. Guess what? A dozen countries tried it. For the most part, all of them were Eastern European former parts of the Soviet Union that got out of the Soviet Union in the early 90s. These were countries that had no investment capital. Just about everybody was poor, so they didn't have any big range of rich and poor people. They didn't have to offset that. And they went to a flat rate tax. Estonia was the first one, and then Latvia and Lithuania, then Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic, Slovakia, like that. And for about 5 years it worked. Rich people did come into those countries to take advantage of that lower tax rate. And they didn't need graduated rates to offset income inequality like rich countries do. And then what happened is they all ran into the 2008-2009 recession, and they just couldn't bring in enough money to make it work. And it turns out the man who designed the flat tax in Slovakia was very proud of his work. He was really proud of this flat tax he designed. And they got rid of it after about 6 years. And he said to me, you know, there's just a basic problem with it. You can't set that rate high enough to bring in the revenue you need, but low enough for average working families to pay. You gotta raise rates on the rich or you can't make it work. So most of those countries have given up on the flat tax. A few, Hungary, Estonia was the first, so they've kept it. And to make it work, they have to raise the rates of all their other taxes. So Hungary is the world champion at sales taxes. The sales tax in Hungary on everything you buy is 27%. But the income tax rate is 15% for everybody. So that's the trade-off. In Estonia, they were the first one to do it. So it's kind of their trademark in international trade circles. Their income tax rate is now 19%. But to pay for it, their Social Security tax, we have a Social Security tax where the worker pays 6.5% and the employer pays 6.5%. Their Social Security tax is 34%. And they have an unemployment rate of about 18%. And this economist in Estonia says to me, I keep telling the government, don't they get it? He said, you know, if you make every employer pay 34% on top of the salary, they're not going to hire anybody. No wonder we have 18% unemployment. But anyway, that's the flat tax. So the right likes the flat tax. I argue it works fine if you're a former Soviet republic with no investment income and the economy is growing. The left likes the carbon tax. Several countries have tried a carbon tax. Australia put in a carbon tax, and it lasted 2 years. In the next election, the government that put it in lost, and the new government their slogan was axe the tax. What happened was they put in a carbon tax. Australia has a lot of coal, and all the power companies burn coal to generate electricity, and everybody's electric bill went up immediately. And the power companies very thoughtfully put on every bill, your bill went up because of this tax we have to pay. And it died. It didn't work. So that one turns out to be hard to do, too. Many other ideas like that have been tried. The best idea, where America has really lost out, and I argue for this strenuously, is the value-added tax, the VAT. This is a tax that was invented in France in the 1950s. It's kind of a sales tax, a super sales tax. It's a sales tax. In America, the retail sales tax only applies when you buy the book from this store and you have to pay a tax on it. In a value-added tax country, when the publisher bought the paper and ink, they paid a value-added tax on the paper and ink. And then when the publisher sold the book to the wholesaler paid a value-added tax, the distributor paid a value-added tax, the bookstore paid a value-added tax, and you. The income is about the same, the revenue to the government. But the thing is, because this has to be paid at every level, it's a very hard tax to evade. It's very easy for government to track, and it's a hard tax to evade. Also, it doesn't tax labor or savings or investment. It taxes consumption. Economists like that. So 176 countries have done the value-added tax. I argue in my book, and what you do is if you have that tax, then you can lower the rate of the corporate and personal income tax or some other tax and give people a break. So I argue in my book we ought to do it. This professor, Eric Zolt, at UCLA Law School, was an advisor of mine on this book. He's designed tax codes for about 40 countries, and he says it would be malpractice not to give a value-added tax. It's such a good tax, and you need it. So he says to me, you know, the VAT, it's such a good idea. Even the U.S. Congress will eventually figure it out. He says, mark my words, within 5 years, the United States will have a VAT. And then he said, I've been saying that for 20 years. But we ought to do it. I think we ought to do it. I went to New Zealand. They have a very good tax code. And anyway, I went to the World Bank and said, who should I go see? Who has a really smart tax code? And they said, well, you might try New Zealand. And I said, whoa, skiing, bungee jumping, bike riding. Yeah, not bad. So I did go. I had a wonderful time there. They got around to a VAT not until 1990, which is fairly late. And the finance minister there said to me, you know, we knew we needed a VAT. Every country ought to have a VAT. He's kind of looking at the American here. But we couldn't call it a VAT because every Kiwi who goes to Britain on vacation hates paying the VAT. So I needed the tax, but I couldn't call it the VAT. So he called it the GST, the Goods and Services Tax. It's the same tax. And I say to this guy, really, you tax services, you tax services. And he said, yeah, we tax services. Like what? He says, well, architects, lawyers, doctors, interior designers, you know, whatever service. And in New Zealand, prostitution is legal. So I said to him, well, how about the sex worker down at the brothel? Does the sex worker have to collect the 18%? And he says to me, like it's the obvious, most obvious thing. He says, oh, yeah, of course. He says, we haven't figured out whether it's a good or a service, but we know it's taxable. Anyway, so that's what I did. I went around the world looking at what we should do to fix our unfair, rotten, inefficient tax code to make it simpler for us to pay, to make it easier for the government to collect, to even out some of the disparities in payments so that the richest people in America don't pay less than their secretaries. And my argument is, yeah, we could do this. We could do this. I can summarize the whole book in one sentence. You still have to buy it. This doesn't give you a break. You may be too busy to read my book. I can understand that. I mean, you could still buy it. That doesn't take any time. But here's my pitch. If we could find the will to fix our rotten tax code, if we had the political will to fix what's wrong with our taxes, if we had the will, the other rich countries could show us the way. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I also heard you in the afternoon on the radio the other day on What's-Her-Name's show.
So. With Terry, yeah.
Terry Gross.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it was good. Both were great. And certainly the VAT sounds like a good way to go. But you mentioned first that economists like it because it's a consumption tax. Not sure all economists feel that way, but I guess a lot do.
Well, yeah,
but
okay.
Beyond that, consumption is a big part of the U.S. Economy, sort of retail consumption is a big part of the U.S. economy.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Can you pull it out? Yeah, right.
There you go. Yeah.
There we go. Okay. I guess it's better if I don't pull it out. Is that right? If I bend over, how about that? And that's a solution. So anyway, with it, with our economy depending on consumption so heavily, 2/3 or whatever, it kind of implies that this, if we went to a VAT tax, it would change a lot of things. It would make for fundamental changes. The result might be good, but sounds like it would be kind of disruptive. Prices would go up and I don't know, can you kind of comment on how hard it would be to get there? What realistically, even if politically we had the will to do it, what sort of a transition period would we have to go through and what would that be like?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So I go into this in some detail in the book, but the issue about a VAT is it depends on where you set the rate, but if the rate is higher than the sales tax we're paying now, that raises the price of everything. And that's hard for low-income people to pay, and it presumably influences people not to do as much consumption. What the other countries have found is, while there is that blip at first, because they use that tax to lower the rates of other taxes, people have higher take-home pay. Their other tax went down, and therefore they have a little more money to spend. It's a regressive tax in that low-income people spend more of their income on consumption than the rich. That's fixable. I don't want to take the time to go into details, but other countries have faced that problem. It's definitely a problem. That's fixable. That can be done. Conservatives don't like the VAT because they call it a money machine. It brings in a lot of money. And in most countries, although it doesn't have to be this way, in most countries it's an invisible tax. So in Britain, you pay £25 for the book, The book is priced at £25, and you hand over £25, right? And if you look on the back, it says this book costs £23.40, and the rest is VAT. But nobody notices that. And after the 2008-2009 recession, as I say in the book, there were different ways for countries to go. Some countries decided to prime the pump. In the U.S., we took 2% off the Social Security tax. We tried to cut taxes to get people to spend more. But many other countries moved to austerity and raised taxes. And in Britain, they raised the VAT from 17.5% to 20% on everything you buy. But in Britain, that tax is hidden. So the price of the book went from £25 to £26.50. But people blame the bookseller. They blame Brad for that, or the publisher. They don't realize it's the government. And as a matter of fact, 2 years later, in the next election, in the polling, the conservative government, which raised the tax, was rated by most British voters as the low-tax party because they didn't see it. So that can be a problem. It doesn't have to be that way. In Canada, they have a goods and services tax, and it's visible. That is, there's a price for the object, and then the GST is added on at the cash register, so you do see yourself paying it. So there are some issues with the VAT. Overall, I think it's a good idea. That's why 176 countries have done it. And although it does raise prices, you can lower taxes and raise people's take-home pay, so it works out okay, I think.
So you don't think it would necessarily have an effect one way or the other on GDP?
No, it shouldn't have an effect on GDP if you use it to offset other taxes. Yeah. Hi.
Well, another thing about VAT is that it requires good administration. I've been in countries where we've worked to introduce it. But my question, I worked on Capitol Hill back when it more or less functioned. And I came to the conclusion that the only groups that benefited consistently from legislation were the accountants and the lawyers. And but we did have some tax simplification, so-called, in 1986. And I remember thinking to myself, wow, this is a fantastic opportunity for the lobbyists to, they've got a nice, not total tabula rasa, but a pretty good thing on which to lobby for all these different loopholes. And it's very hard to see how you can overcome this structure of the enormous number of interests that thrive off the complexity of our damn tax code.
No, you're absolutely right. In 1986, we did the best tax reform in American history. Economists love it. Politicians love it. Tax collectors love it. And what they did is they took away a lot of the giveaways. They took away a lot of exemptions and depreciation allowances and credits, and therefore were able to lower the rates. In 1980, the top marginal rate in America was 70%. After 1986, it went to 28%, and with no loss of revenue because they got rid of all the good giveaways. And as you say, shortly thereafter, the lobbyists came back in and started larding up the tax code with these giveaways again. And that happens in America more than in other countries, because money talks in our politics. Our Supreme Court has said that spending money on politicians is a form of free speech and can't be controlled. No other court has said that. And therefore, they tend to get their way in Congress. But my argument is 1986 is a good model. We could do it again. If we got rid of a lot of giveaways, we could lower rates. And the way you do, in many countries in my book, I saw how they did tax reform. The only way to make it work is you got to do it big. Bill Bradley, Senator Bill Bradley, is kind of the intellectual driver behind the 1986 Act. He says you got to fix the whole damn thing. And that's true. And if you do it big, really big, then for every part of it that somebody doesn't like, there's some other piece that they do like, and you can make the politics work, which is what happened in 1986. Many countries have done it that way. There are just so many, in my view, nutty giveaways in our tax code. There are hundreds and hundreds of exemptions and credits. I have a scene in my book where the president goes down Pennsylvania Avenue to Congress and says, I got a great new idea. Let's have the Secretary of the Treasury send a check for $7,500 to anybody who buys a $138,000 BMW hybrid car. This would be a boon to rich people buying that car. It'll be a boon to German auto manufacturers. It'll add $740 million a year to the tax, to our deficit. We'd never do this, would we? I mean, it's crazy. Yeah, we did it. It's in the tax code. Because that's a tax break. It's not spending. We should get rid of all those, is what I say. I mean, I'm absolutely pure in the book. I'm not doing it. I'm not in Congress, so you can say this. But we should get rid of all of them. Then you could lower the rate sharply, make the whole thing simpler, and make April 15th just a sunny spring day. And my argument is, for everything people lost, there'd be something good they won, and they'd go for it.
Hi. I also heard you on NPR.
Yeah.
And I've been following taxes since 1984. And one of the things I thought you were going to bring up was the fair tax bill that has been in Congress since 1999. Fair tax is H.R. 25 for people who want to look it up. And you can just go online and look at it. Because it does virtually everything you say, but it does it a lot simpler. I think the problem is you start out trying to redeem something that's irredeemable, which is the tax system. You have to get rid of it. You know, it's only been in existence since 1913, and most people didn't start paying it till after World War II. So there's no reason for it. The country didn't exist with it. And so therefore, but the fair tax does everything it does, but it does it simpler because it eliminates all, it just abolishes the income tax. There would be no more personal and corporate income tax. So there would be no more personal and corporate forms. Plus, it taxes consumption, but it doesn't tax productivity. So everybody gets to keep everything they make and they don't have to pay any taxes on wages or savings. But also, then, it only taxes very specific things. It only taxes the sale, the retail sale of goods and services, the taxes services like you were talking about. But it doesn't tax the sale of used goods. So if you bought a new car, you would pay a federal sales tax on it. But if you buy a used car, you don't pay any federal sales tax on it, because the philosophy is you only should be taxed once on a service.
So the fair tax is in my book, and this, as you say, it's a consumption tax, and the proponents say it will replace all the other taxes.
But
sadly,
also,
the
but it also, but the most the key thing,
it provides
a prebate. Every family, every month, gets a prebate, gets money given to them to offset up to the poverty level for a family of whatever size, family of 1, 2, 4, whatever. It gives every family a prebate to offset the projected fair tax base on essential goods and services.
Yeah, so this is the problem. We're going to get rid of the corporate income tax. We're going to get rid of the individual income tax. You have to pay a consumption tax, but we're going to give you the money to pay that tax at the beginning of the year.
And your own money.
Where's the
revenue?
The problem
is,
where's the revenue? And the answer that the proponents of the fair tax propose is what's called dynamic scoring. I bet you guys know dynamic scoring. This is the idea that says if we just cut taxes, there'd be so much more business. People would work harder, and there'd be more sales, and it would generate more revenue. It's a something for nothing plan. You know, it's the Laffer curve. Let's cut rates and we'll get more revenue. It's a wonderful idea. I mean, you know, it's in your dreams. It's great. I'm going to pay less and get more. Guess what? It's never worked. It's never worked. You can't find a time when it worked. George W. Bush gave us the two biggest tax cuts in American history. He said it was going to create 25 million new jobs. Actually, revenues fell, and 4 years later, we had the worst recession in 75 years. So these are nice ideas, but they don't work, unfortunately. The numbers don't add up. If you say, by magic, revenues are going to go up when I tax you less, well, you can make the numbers add up on paper, but it's just never worked. It would be nice if it did.
But a lot of people would like to get all their money.
If I could interrupt just real briefly, I want to be sure we can get to the book signing, have enough time for it. I'm sure anyone else who has a question. Did you have?
Yeah.
I'll call this
yeah.
the last question.
Sort of follow up on the complexity issue, but say for the corporate side.
Yeah.
I mean, not only the opportunity for corruption with the corporate income tax, all the intellectual capital of the tax lawyers and the accountants, and do you have any numbers on how much we're wasting on that? And are there any countries that don't have a corporate income tax?
All countries have, well, yeah, a few countries. Bermuda has a zero corporate income tax. Ireland's is 12%. Switzerland's ranges from 2 to 6%, depending on what you negotiate with the government. Most countries have a corporate income tax. And you're right, it's so complicated and it's so full of loopholes and giveaways that it's a haven for tax lawyers and accountants. And we could simplify it. Same thing we ought to do with the individual income tax, get rid of the deductions and loopholes. And, you know, every exemption that gets into the tax code, there is a justification for it. The reason they're going to give you $7,500 to buy that hybrid BMW is because it reduces oil consumption. So then why then is there a tax break for buying a recreational vehicle, which increases tax oil consumption? They don't follow. And of course, once they get in the code, they never die. They're permanent. They're there forever. So the best approach is to start, you know, zero budget, just get rid of all of them. And then the lobbyists will try to get them in there. In Australia, when they did this, the lobbyists came in and said, well, we need this break. You know, the other guys, the hell with them, but my company needs this break. And the finance minister said, if I give you that break, I got to raise tax rates for every Australian. We're not going to do that. And that's the standard, the position you have to take. I think you have to be absolutely firm about it and take away all the goodies. I won't go into detail here, but I say we should take away the charitable contribution deduction and the mortgage interest deduction, which are the two most popular. If you read my book, you'll see why this is absolutely right. The complications have created a whole industry. I just give you one example. So all countries want to give a tax break to people who will put aside money for retirement. This is important. And in the United States, we have a 401k, a 403b, a 527b, we have a SEP, a SARSEP, an ESOP, we have a Roth IRA, we have a regular IRA, we have a MIRA. We have something called a simple IRA. Guess what? In order to use the simple IRA, you have to fill out two IRS forms every year. There's a billion-dollar industry just to advise people on how to put money in the bank. It doesn't have to be that way. In Canada, they have something called the tax-free savings account. Here are the rules. Anybody can use it. You can put the money anywhere you want. You can take it out anywhere you want. You can use it for anything you want. And the interest in dividends and gain on it are always tax-free. Very simple. We could do that too, but because of the way our system works, we've made everything really complicated. Time has come to, as I say in my book, simplify, as Ezra Pound famously said. If we did that, we could get lower rates, we could make things simpler, and we could have a tax code, finally, that Americans could be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you all so much for coming out. If you'd like to have your book signed, please line up to the right of the podium. And